Okay, good afternoon everybody. So I am Muthu Subramanian. This time I chose a little different topic in the sense that instead of talking about what I did in the previous year, I'm trying to talk about what we are currently doing and then what we plan to do. Specifically from the point of interoperability in Impress. Though there are points which are applicable to LibreOffice as a whole, I would try and concentrate on Impress specifically here. These are the three things that I plan to cover. One is the master slides versus the layouts. There are a lot of people who would face who have faced troubles with the layouts. You know, when you get a PPTX or PPT. From PowerPoint, you import and you try exporting, your layouts go haywire. We'll see why that happens and what we could do about it. And the fill angles, a bit about the gradients fill angles specifically. The missing features like we do not have gradient fills for text, for example, or for lines. People use workarounds like using an image of a line and then dragging it across, and it seems to work most cases, but not a very elegant solution. So let's see. Some background. So I work with Ericsson currently. In Ericsson we have a group of people who use LibreOffice, and most of the other people use MS Office. So most of these problems occur because because of the templates and the corporate documents that are there in either PPT, doc, etc. And here we have a pool of LibreOffice users who try and use that and send documents across. And the others complain that, you know, there are problems broken, etc. So that's the background there. So starting with the master slides. I have taken snippets from different sources, including Office Help. So they put it this way. So a master slide is the top slide in the hierarchy of slides that store information about theme, slide layouts, etc. So if you see here, the most important point is around the kind of look that the slide is storing. You know, the colors, the background colors, the fonts, effects, etc. The layouts, the slide layouts, are more to do with the placeholders on them. So it's like you have a master slide and then you have different layouts. You can place your text there. Normally, again, one set of layouts of a theme will have one master slide. There is no reason why, but that's how they keep arranging that way. Let's see. So this is the idea behind the master slide and the layout, but you know, reality is different. Layouts contain the look related objects as well. Like you see here, this is one of the standard MS Office master slide and the layouts that you get. The first layout itself has a different background. Everything is different. And in many cases, or at least in quite some cases where you see, you know, the layouts actually reuse very little from the master slide, maybe just the footer elements here and there, but in a way they kind of become a new slide of its own. Coming to LibreOffice, what we do is we have master slides which are named differently. Sometimes they are called master pages in some places, sometimes they are called slide designs. Pretty confusing. They use different naming everywhere. Like if you right click, it's called the slide design, and if you use a view, it's called the master slides, and so on. Again, these take care of the elements of the placeholders to some extent. But there are layouts in LibreOffice which are mainly very strict in the sense that they just have the placeholders, like you see bottom there. They do not have any look and feel elements. There are no images or anything. They're just text boxes which you can place elsewhere. That said, this is majorly hard-coded. You don't have so much flexibility to change the 12 slides that you have. There was some bit of work done in GSOC by Vish in trying to move these things into an XML file and so on. So some bit of work is there. Currently, these are defined in layoutlist.xml. You do have some flexibility to change it, but it's not easy at all. And that file is specific to LibreOffice installation. So you would have to go there and manually change stuff there. It's a bit of pain indeed. So now coming to the next set, which is interesting here, is what happens when we actually import it. We have a PPTX slide, or let's say a DBT, and we import it in LibreOffice. What happens is, let's say you have one master slide and two layouts, L1 and L2, and you have the second master slide is M2 and probably a layout called L3. And probably there's only one slide in this deck, which is slide 1, which uses the layout 1 and hence the master page 1. So when you import this, that is what you see there. You would see a merged master slide in Impress and a slide to it. So the rest of the items are in a way dropped completely. So you would get the contents in M1 and L1 depending on what parts are being used and the slide one, of course, the rest are dropped. So what do we do when we export this? So that's an interesting case. So when we actually export this, we do not have the layout information now. So we have the merged master page there when you export. And these two 12 slide layouts that are there, they are directly exported. So it's kind of hard-coded. So what happens if you have two master pages in Impress? So what happens is then you get two sets of those, in a way, dummy layouts, if you can call them as. So you kind of get 12 plus 12, 24 layouts, which are nothing but just copies of this and the master page. This is what happens actually. So troubles here, of course, multiple master slides. So in a way, the original file had one master slide and probably n number of slides. Now it becomes n number of master slides because your layouts, if you see here, let's say you had another slide which uses L2, you would actually end up having two master slides there, which is L1 plus M1 and L2 plus M1. So you would have two master slides, and when you export it, now you have 2 into 12, which is 24 layouts being exported, actually. All the layouts are, like I said, standard, because they are in a way kind of hard-coded in Impress. And specifically, the problems occur when it starts dropping master slides and layouts, because the corporate documents, where you have the branding elements, etc., have layouts which are specific, and they contain look and feel elements as well. Now when you save them, they are, or rather when you import them, they are dropped there. There is no relation between original layouts and exported layouts, like you can see. The original layouts are probably from MS Office because of look and feel, etc., but when you export it, it's the standard ones. So, like I said, the template documents break heavily because of this one. Let's see what we can do about it. One thing that we can do is we can create file-specific layouts in LibreOffice, which is basically the Impress. This kind of makes it easier for people to create file-specific layouts, but then it still does not contain look-related elements there. What we can also do is try and create child master slides. In a way, if you see the MS Office, it's nothing but, they also are in a way master slides, though they are called layouts, but they kind of do the work that the master pages do as well. So these are, if you consider two levels, we can create probably n levels of them. But again, it gives a maximum flexibility. You can add your look and feel elements, you can have a child of a child of a child, and so on. But the UI would be tricky. How would you edit them and it could become very, very confusing for the user. So what we can instead do, or what we are trying to do right now in the process, is that we can round trip the master pages from the original file. So let's say we have the merge slide, merge master page, and then the slide, and you're trying to export it. The original set of slides, which is basically the M1, L1, L2, M2, L3, comes from the original file that's basically here. So this set is, we can directly export them there first, and then we can export the additional master pages that are required by the slides. This way, in a way, we can save the master pages and the layouts. We will not lose them. This seems to work so far, but then there would be surely loopholes there. When you export it again, we need to be a little careful in terms of trying to see that, okay, yeah, this is what we have. When you import it, so when you actually import it, so we need to be careful that, okay, this set of slides were created by Imprint, so we just import those two happily. So yeah, so we are trying to do some work around this. We have done some POCs, etc. We hope to see this soon implemented in Breakfast. But otherwise, any questions so far till here?
Do they just have two levels, or do they have multiple levels?
As far as I know, they have just two levels. I'm not sure if they have multiple. Any other question? Okay, so the next feature that we are talking about is the gradient angle fill. I should refer the retina's analysis here. This is part of one of the bugs which we had raised, and we are trying to fix that. Is that in our documents we have very specific gradient fill needs to be diagonal. Yeah, it's easier for a square. Just say 45 degrees and you're happy. But what happens is that when you make it as a rectangle, it's no longer 45 degrees. Now you have the fill, which is, the angle is 45 degrees of the fill, but the diagonal is lost. So what we currently do is manually have a kind of a plugin for automatically finding out, okay, what the angle needs to be. But if you need to do it manually, it becomes really tricky to find the angle. You can do it approximately only, but not specifically say, okay, you need the diagonal fill. What is required is this, which is called the scaled angles. So it's 45 degrees, but for a rectangle, you use scaled angle. So it kind of becomes diagonal always. So one of the ways to do this is of course, implement the scale attribute in the ODF and implement it. Probably a lot easier. The other one, which is also suggested by Rishna, was to use the SVG's fill. We can use SVG's linear gradient fill inside the ODF specification. But I think this would be a generic solution, which means that we have all the SVG features, which is good. But at the same time, it would probably take a little longer to implement this one, because you need to do it for both input export and the features as well to do this one. We are currently doing the first set, which is basically the implementing the scale attribute for the ODF files, the gradient fill, which is probably nicer. Okay, any questions in this section? Okay, moving on then. We have a gradient fill for text and lines, which is quite interesting. This is a screenshot from Emma's office. If you see there, the hello world has yellow color to kind of a blackish color. Gradient being filled in at an angle, I think 45 degrees is what I used. If you use a long line, then it kind of becomes, each line is used as a set. So the first line is filled with the gradient, from start to end, with an angle, whatever you need. The second line is treated as a fresh line and then filled across. There's actually one single line, because it's a long line, it gets cut and then puts it into the next line. But the fill itself is treated separately. Again, there, if you start adding, let's say, a couple of, the dots at the end, the fill automatically becomes now from the start to the end. So as you type, it kind of changes. Again, it's not individual character being a different color. The individual character itself has a gradient. So it looks much more nicer in a way. One of the solutions which I was thinking was instead of trying to fill the gradient across the characters, is just use separate colors for the text, which is kind of a simple solution, but may not look all that great, because you would find yellow, then probably some other color and so on separately. But nevertheless, that's probably a solution there. That said, it also has multi-stop gradients. You can have, let's say, a number of colors there, and it can fill from yellow to blue, blue to red, red to black, in this case. Same goes for lines. You can have lines, gradient lines, and the color multi-stop gradients with lines as well. Currently, like I said, what we do is we kind of store it as image, and we give it as a gallery, so somebody can drag and drop, drag it across, and do. It's not a very elegant solution. That said, we can have such designs, but you can also have for shapes. This simple rectangle, but then you can have shapes, and the shapes, the lines, and the shapes itself can have the gradient fills, etc. You can also have a mix, basically area fill and the line fill, and you can have them separate. Why we need it is basically, it looks pretty, more features, of course, but then the major point here is there are a lot of organizations which have branding materials which depend on these. They have specific colors, they have specific stops, they have specific angles. Like I said, in Ericsson, there's a specification that it has to go from diagonal one end to the other end. So in such cases, using LibreOffice becomes very tricky currently. So we are trying to do this feature so that it becomes nicer for them. What is required? Of course, we need to first do the gradients for the text. I mean, you can do it separately, of course, but then, and the gradients for the lines. And then the multi-stop gradients. We do not have multi-stop gradients for the area fill as well. We just have two color gradients. There was some work being done by Synerzip, but I don't think it's merged yet. Let's see. References, these are some of the references which I said I took the content from. That said, any other questions so far? Well, that's it then for my side. Thank you so much.
Do you have a question?
Sure.
The multi-stop gradients, how do you serialize them? How do you write them as XML?
Okay, so there are... so there are let's say OXML, you can actually specify the stops, call the gradient stops. You specify the stops and you say, okay, at this particular percentage of the point, this color changes something else.
Yeah.
You have a gradient color as a set of element, and then you have the stops as individual stuff.
Okay. And then ODF, this is not yet possible. Are you thinking about a proposal on how to make it possible?
Yeah, the one way is to use SVG if SVG supports it. But otherwise, implementing this in first in the core probably is a little easier. What we are trying to do is, if you see the multi-stop gradients are nothing but you can break it down into two gradients. Right?
Ah, yeah.
So from yellow to blue, you first do it, and then from blue to, let's say, red, and then from red to black. That's kind of an easy way. That's what we are trying to do first. But then, yeah, when you write it into XML, you can actually write it out as stops, specify the stops.
Yeah, okay. When you use gradients, you have indeed a strong, if you say from blue to red to green, you have indeed a point where it's a strong, full green color in between. And yeah, okay.
Yeah. So it's actually that. So when you actually put a stop there at the blue, it's the same thing. Visibly, there's not much difference.
Yeah, okay. I find particularly the work on the master page is very interesting. Of course, those nice colors are, I like colors, it's really, what you say for business branding, but master pages, if that works better, it's of course, I think it's a big win.
Yeah, that's a case for everybody, I think.
Yeah.
And for us, the interoperability, there's a lot of things which break because we drop stuff.
Yeah.
And we also merge stuff, which is yeah. But yeah, I think we'll take one step at a time. Yeah, we'll do the round tripping first, and probably attack the other ones later. Any other question as well?
Will the gradients support transparency?
In a way, but normally what I've seen so far is that they're just gradient colors, and then that's what's going on. But that's a good question. I haven't dug that yet. Maybe I should check. There is surely the object transparency, but I'm not sure about whether you can choose a color and specify a transparency there so that the text itself becomes maybe transparent and suddenly and translucent. Interesting. Yeah. Any other question? If not, then thank you so much. Thanks a lot.